Good day. I'm Julie Nonnekens, and together with my colleague Laura Mezzanotte, I will present to you a work of our ACE molecular and cellular imaging. This ACE is centered around the two core facilities, optical imaging center and the AMI facility, and many different departments are involved in this technology-driven ACE. So in the ACE, we do imaging on many different levels. So for example, we start with molecules, DNA, RNA, proteins with optical imaging with microscopes. We can do microscopic imaging in whole organisms, going from optical to anatomical imaging with PET, MRI, ultrasound and CT. And these can also be applied, of course, in patients for human and population imaging. For image-guided surgery, MRI, PET and SPECT, for example. This is all combined with image processing to get the most optimal data from all of these imagings. So I would like to present one of our projects in my group today, and this is centered around the concept of theranostics. In theranostics, we have the aim to target tumor-specific entities, such as receptors, with a targeting molecule that can be labeled with the radioactive isotope. And this can be used for either diagnosis for cancer patients with PET and SPECT imaging, or it can be used for targeted radionuclide therapy when we use DNA damaging radionuclides. So in my lab, we aim to better understand these sort of targeted radionuclide therapies and use this knowledge to improve the treatment efficacy. And for this, we use in vitro experiments. For example, we do screens to find novel combination treatments, but we also image DNA damage processes with our new microscope. We also do in vivo imaging and therapy studies to look at localization, for example, of a new radio tracer and look at therapeutic efficacies of these novel tracers. And we also do in silico modeling, where we can do dosimetric calculations based on biological inputs. So the study I want to show you today is where we looked at better understanding of the tumor and normal tissue effects of peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. And at the end, we want to use this information to design a better combination treatment. In this study, we used xenografted mice with a positive tumor that can be targeted with targeted radionuclide therapy. We gave a dose of lutetium dotatate, which is a beta particle emitter that is used for the treatment of neuroendocrine tumors. And we sacrificed animals at different time points where we looked at the histology of the tissues, we did imaging and did all sorts of analyses. So here you can see a SPECT MRI scan of a mouse at different time points after injection. And you can clearly see uptake in the kidneys and in the tumor, which you would also expect. The tumor is, of course, targeted region, and the kidneys, there's uptake because it's cleared via the kidneys from the body. And you can see that even up to 11 to 14 days after injection in the animal, we can still see radioactive uptake in the tumor. This we can also measure when we take out the organs, so we do a biodistribution, and here you can see also that we have major uptake in the kidneys and mostly in the tumors, which persist over time. So we wanted to compare these because if we want to extrapolate these to patients, we can of course not do a biodistribution, but we need to do imaging for this. And if we would look at the SPECT imaging, compare it to the biodistribution, this is for the tumor. We do see a very nice correlation between the ex vivo measurement and what we saw with the SPECT scan. And this is the same for the kidneys, meaning that the imaging of these mice can be a very nice tool if you want to have the uptake in the organs. So what we also did is we looked at the therapeutic efficacy of this drug. And here you can see mice, the growth of a tumor from mice that were not treated. And when they were treated with the treatment, you can see shrinkage and then grow back. And when we look at different time points in these mice, we can, for example, look at the induction of cell death. So when the cells are targeted with the treatment, they are supposed to die. And this can be done with an immunofluorescent staining that we can analyze with a microscope. And in green, you can see your cells that are dying. And this is an example 5 days after treatment. And when we've quantified this over time, you can clearly see that there is induction of DNA damage and it slowly goes down. And this is because dead cells are cleared from the tumor. And what you can also appreciate here is that there's large heterogeneity. There are areas that are not dying and there are areas that are completely dying. What you can also see here is at 4 days after treatment, we can see the highest level of cell death, and that's the moment when the tumors start to shrink. And at about 2 weeks after treatment, you can see that the tumors start to grow back, and this is also when our cell death is going down. So that's a nice correlation between what we can see on the whole tumor level and what we can measure in the site tumors. So I said that this therapy functions by inducing DNA damage. This is also something we can image with a microscope. And for that, we have different markers. For example, here you see one cell. This is about 10 micrometers and different dots in there. And every dot is a DNA damage that's induced by the treatment. And this we can also quantify in the tumors with two different markers, 53BP1 and gamma-H2X, who are markers for DNA double-strand breaks. And this we can quantify over time. And what you can also see is here that we have induction of DNA damage for both markers. And this goes down over time. And again, here we see this large heterogeneity. So some cells have major DNA damage, some cells have much less. And this corresponds nicely to what we saw with induction of cell death. So we looked into this. What is causing this heterogeneous response? Because in theory, you would expect to have a very homogeneous response, but we did not. We looked at different factors. For example, proliferation and blood vessels, that was all not the reason for this. So what we also did, we looked at receptor expression because we're targeting these receptors. And this we also looked at too with microscopy stainings. So here you can see a picture of a large field of the tumor. In red, you can see the receptors. And in green, you can see the DNA damage that is induced. And you can already see here in red that there is a large heterogeneity in receptor expression. So if we look, for example, at a high and a low expressing area and we zoom in, then we can quantify the DNA damage induced in these areas. So we segment these areas. This we do with the imaging processing. Afterwards, we quantify the number of DNA breaks in these areas. And then we found indeed that in the high expressing areas, we have more DNA damage induced than in the low expressing areas, showing that the level of receptor expression is really vital for the level of therapeutic efficacy. And we could also recapitulate this in cells. So this is done in tumors, that is done in cells in culture, where you could also see that there's a large heterogeneity in receptor expression. Here the receptors are marked in green. And if we look at the combination with DNA damage, indeed, we do see that there is an increase in the high receptor expressing cells compared to the low receptor expressing cells. So is this important? What does it mean? What we do see in these tumors is that we do have, at non-treated tumors, there's a large heterogeneity, quite high receptor expression. And if you look in time, this receptor expression goes down, meaning that we either lose the receptor expression or the high expressing cells die. Meaning this is really relevant for to protect therapeutic efficacy. And this is also when you look at the patient sample. These are two different patient samples from patients with neuroendocrine tumors where we also stained for the receptor. And here you can already see that between patients, there's a huge difference in receptor expression, and there's also heterogeneity that can be seen in patient number two and not in patient number one, showing the applicability from what we found in the mouse and cell model to human patients. With that, I would like to stop. Thanks to everyone who was involved in this study, and I would like to give the word to my colleague, Laura.
Thanks, Julie. Now let's move to the second part of this talk. Hello, I'm Laura Mezzanotte, and I am assistant professor at the Department of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine. And today I will illustrate how my research is exploiting bioluminescence for cellular and molecular imaging. First of all, bioluminescence is a chemical reaction. It employs an enzyme called luciferase, which reacts with a substrate called luciferin. The reaction generates light as end product. And this reaction is still used today to evaluate extraterrestrial samples for signs of life as we know it. But for biomedical application, luciferase have been cloned as a reporter gene. Another quick note is that bioluminescence is different than fluorescence. In fluorescence, you have excitation light that generates high photons emissions, while in bioluminescence, you don't. This means that there is no phototoxicity and no photobleaching. But the light generation generated is much lower. On the other hand, the background is negligible, and this allows high sensitivity of detection and high detectability. In fluorescence, you can use both proteins and dyes, and this leads to application in the clinic like fluorescence image-guided surgery. Although bioluminescence cannot be translated to the clinic as a imaging technique, it can be exploited for precision health. Wearable sensor can be built. For example, the DIA watch prototype that has been developed by researchers at the University of Edinburgh, comprised of a clear container inserted in a watch in which bioluminescent bacteria, bioluminescent activator, and nutrients are together. The bioluminescence activator compete with glucose. When the level of glucose drop in the sweat, then the bioluminescence activator can activate light, and this generate the luminescence in the watch. This type of wearable sensor can be employed, for example, as alarm for hypoglycemia in diabetics. Coming back to a bioanalytical application of bioluminescence, usually you see luciferases employed to build cell-based assays to study protein-protein interaction or for in vivo imaging of gene expression and cell tracking. And there are two main categories of luciferases, the terrestrial and the marine luciferases. The terrestrial one emit mostly green light, but thanks to mutagenesis and creation on novel substrate analogs, now we have a palette of multicolor luciferases that span from red to near infrared. In the marine luciferases, colenterazine is employed in the reaction. They're mostly blue, and now they can be turned into red and yellow. However, some of the marine luciferases are really, really bright, and this leads to their application for cellular imaging. In the example I'm showing you here, I'm using a protein called Antares, which is a fusion between nanoleuc luciferase and an orange fluorescent protein, to image single cell just with a wide field microscope. Before it was possible, but with the normal firefly luciferase, it took like minutes to get an image, while with this new nanoleuc luciferase, milliseconds and seconds are required. And now we move to in vivo application. When you use bioluminescence in vivo in small animals or in organs, what you need is that luciferase is genetically engineered on your cell or bacteria or virus of interest. And then the substrate is administered to the animals. The animals are placed in this imager, which is just a black box with a CCD camera on top, and the images are acquired. In this first example, I want to show you how, for example, we could track therapeutic mesenchymal stem cells in wall, porcine, liver. This work in collaboration with Leti's group on EMC was important to show how the stem cells distribute in the wall organ. And why we want to study this? It's because maybe therapeutic mesenchymal stem cells can help the organ to survive better from explant to transplant in the new patients. And here, for example, you can see that bioluminescent cells can be visualized after injection. You can see an anterior, a posterior view of the organ during a machine perfusion. And also 30 minutes after, you can see that the bioluminescence goes more to the edges of the organ because the cells are evenly distributed in the organ. And then again, we use bioluminescence to track hair follicle stem cells in brain injury mice. These mice had a brain injury, as you can see on the MRI on top, there is a lesion. And we were interested to know the behavior of the cells in the mice. So, well, with bioluminescence, we could see that the cells survived in the animal for a long time. And also, since the cells were labeled with SPIO, which are iron oxide nanoparticle, we could see the cells, the precise anatomical location of the cells in the brain of the mice, like you see in the lower panel of the image. And finally, not only stem cells can be visualized, but also, for example, T cells. In this other work of my group, a transgenic mouse for detection of T cells has been generated. The T cells express a green luciferases, but they turn red upon activation. And for example, we use these mice, the cells from these mice, to study vaccination. We first crossed the mouse with OT1 mouse, which is a classical model in immunology, and the OT1 cells can recognize ovalbumin antigen and get activated for it. So when we vaccinated the mice with dendritic cells cross-presenting ovalbumin, the T cells got activated. What you can see in the lower panel, if we just look for the green luciferase, we see that control mice have some T cells in the body, especially in the inguinal lymph node. But of course, the vaccinated mice have higher number of cells at day 8 because cells proliferated. Moreover, on the right panel, you can see that if we just look for red signal, we don't see anything in the control mice, but we do see it in the vaccinated mice because not only the cells proliferated, but they were activated because of the vaccination. And while you can see all the people I need to thank for this work and the funding agency, I also want to thank you for your attention.